There's a lot of water flowing throughout North Carolina. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency lists roughly 38,200 miles of streams and rivers in the state. Some are large, some are small, and in general, the agency lists the water quality as fairly good. That's thanks in part to the more than 150 wastewater treatment plants around the state. That's according to the North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources. The facilities work hard to remove nutrients and bacteria from the water that they discharge back into the state's waterways.
All right, this stabilized 24.4 degrees C.
24.4 degrees,
okay. pH is 7.55.
But now, scientists are taking an even closer look at the health of North Carolina's rivers and streams. That's because there is a growing concern about the effects of the mix of personal care products and pharmaceuticals that are finding their way into the water.
So we're interested in what are the effects of everything that we put into our waste streams, from our homes to businesses to the university. What happens to those compounds as they pass through the sewage effluent? And ultimately, what is going on in the rivers once they have received those effluents and all the myriad of compounds that end up in that water? Whoops! Trout!
Rainbow!
All right.
Dr. Shea Tuberty and several graduate students are electrofishing in the upper south fork of the New River. A small electrical shock stuns the fish, so scientists can study and release them.
Okay, that's good.
Without harming the fish. Tuberty's been studying this stretch of the fast-moving river for the past 10 years. The section runs through Boone and past Appalachian State University's campus.
This is just a big bluehead chub. We'll give them a closer look in a few minutes.
While all of the fish collected are counted, examined, and released, particular attention is paid to the male fish.
The focus of our research has been on the non-game fishes, so things like these guys. This is a bluehead chub, and this is a male. You can tell it's a male because it's got these tubercle scars over its head here.
Scientists are finding evidence of intersexed fish. That means male fish turning into females. And scientists are asking if that's because of the increase in estrogenic compounds that are being sent down toilets, sinks, and showers.
Specifically, we're looking for effects that mimic estrogens in male fishes in an attempt to measure what percent of the population are feminized by this soup of compounds that end up in the effluent, many of which end up being estrogenic, which is a term that generally means that they're capable of binding to estrogen receptors and eliciting the responses of endogenous estrogens. And then we're looking for a number of things that indicate estrogenic effects. So we could draw blood and look for egg proteins being carried through the blood system. Those are called vitellogenins. We could actually sacrifice the animals and dissect out the testes to see if in fact they have oocytes or eggs developing within the testes, which indicates a condition called intersex, which is commonly used to indicate estrogenic effects in populations. Or you could look at the circulating concentrations of sex hormones as they might be modified by exposure.
Estrogen is a hormone that is important for sexual and reproductive development in females. While treatment plants have been successfully removing nutrients, bacteria, and chemical compounds for years, there are some estrogenic compounds that aren't removed. The amount of estrogenic compounds in the water is small, and the water is considered safe for humans. The fish are safe to eat as well. So far, it appears that not many fish are affected.
It's more environmentally relevant for a fish estrogen receptor versus a human because fish are more sensitive because they have three estrogen receptors, where humans only have two estrogen receptors. So they could pick up more sensitivity.
But what is happening to the fish is a concern, because if the number of transforming fish grows, it could affect the fish population in the river. There simply wouldn't be enough male fish to reproduce.
It's all crawfish coming out.
So if you see less populations of fish, you know, there's probably less reproduction going on. So most likely caused by estrogenic compounds and changing the male to female ratio of the populations.
Scientists are working to pin down the source of the estrogenic compounds. It is possible there isn't just one source.
There's been decades of data to show that dozens of different classes of compounds can actually interact with estrogen receptors, and hundreds of different actual molecules or compounds that we use in our day-to-day business can actually be estrogenic. So it's more the soup effect, the combination of slight effects here and there, different concentrations of many different compounds that elicit the response.
The upper fork of the New River is part of the New River Basin, which runs through North Carolina and Virginia. There are 9 river basins in North Carolina. All of the waterways eventually drain into the sea. And that's another concern. Scientists are finding blue crabs, which live along the coast, also showing evidence of the effects of estrogenic compounds.
So that's what we're looking at. That is a collapsible crab pot. We're going to use this bit of string in the middle to tie a chicken leg on there. We got a drumstick today. It doesn't really matter what kind of chicken you use. And we're just going to deploy it over the side of the boat once we find a good spot where we think there's likely to be some crabs. Crabs mostly work off of chemoreception, and they don't have the best eyesight in the world. Not to say they're blind by any means, but so they're likely going to smell it in the water.
The Masonboro Sound, not far from Wilmington, is one of 4 sampling locations for a study of blue crabs. The Sound is a tidal estuary, which mixes salt water from the sea and fresh water from the land. It turns out that crabs, especially blue crabs, are good indicators of water quality because they filter so much water through their systems.
The kind of stuff that we're looking at in these crabs is going to kind of indicate water quality and kind of health issues that could, in the future, if we keep kind of pouring stuff into water systems the way we are, it could really end up kind of affecting us.
But the crab populations have been declining, and we want to see what kind of hormonal responses or any kind of ecotoxicological effects have been done towards crabs.
The crabs are analyzed in a lab at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington.
We not only collect hepatic pancreas, we also have been collecting sponge, or the eggs, and the ovaries. If this was a male, we would also be looking, we would be getting the vas deferens, which carry the sperm.
In addition, a tissue sample is taken from the reproductive organs to study the RNA, or ribonucleic acid. RNA is a molecule that carries genetic information and guides the production of proteins, which regulate the work of cells.
You're getting a separation of the different biological molecules in this tissue sample here. And so at the top you have your RNA, in the middle this white part is the DNA, and then at the bottom you have your proteins, and you can actually see down here there's a little bit of yellowish, those are the lipids.
Scientists want to see if the crab RNA carries the code for the gene vitellogenin. It's a protein found in the future fish's egg yolk that should only be found in females. It should not be found in males.
So female crabs should be expressing this gene during the reproductive season. It's the gene that eventually gets translated into the protein that becomes the egg yolk for all those wonderful eggs they're going to produce. Now, the jury's still out on this, but some studies have found that male crabs exposed to chemicals that disrupt endocrine function also produce this gene in their hepatopancreas. They shouldn't be producing it, but some of them do. The mechanism behind that is a little bit fuzzy, but what we want to do is look at the crabs from our 4 different sites and compare expression levels, with the hypothesis being that crabs at the sites that are more pristine, the males wouldn't express vitellogenin, whereas crabs from sites that are more polluted, more stressed, you would see males potentially expressing vitellogenin.
The research was prompted after crabbers in Virginia and Maryland began noticing declines in their catches. Concern was increased after North Carolina crabbers noticed the same declines as well, and there was even more concern after reports of finding intersexed crabs in Maryland and Virginia. The bottom line, crabs are safe to eat, they are safe to catch. The goal of the research is to keep it that way. And scientists say the easiest way for residents to help keep the water clean is to dispose of pharmaceuticals at medicine collection points and not down the drain.
They kept asking, what can we do about it? And that was the first, you know, low-hanging fruit you can pick is, you know, stop flushing your pharmaceuticals downstream by putting them in the toilet, which, you know, all the packaging not too long ago was actually using that as the preferred method of eradication.